It sounds like Miyamoto-san was a scary presence for the team. Satoru Iwata's summary of the Paper Mario team's experience is succinct and to the point. In an Iwata Asks interview for Paper Mario Sticker Star, the team behind the iconic Nintendo role-playing games got to air their grievances about working with Shigeru Miyamoto. There were a lot of stories about Miyamoto being obstinate during the initial planning stages of Paper Mario titles, from calling game prototypes boring to wondering, quote, "It's fine without a story, so do we really need one?" According to Thousand Year Door supervisor Kensuke Tanabe, "There were times when Miyamoto-san has really gotten angry at me. We have no shortage of anecdotes in that nature." At the very early stages of planning for Paper Mario: The Thousand Year Door, it was unclear whether the game would even be made at all. When shown an initial pitch for the GameCube title, Miyamoto absolutely refused to give the team the green light to continue development. It's not uncommon for Nintendo to pause or cancel development on any game that isn't working, especially during the early planning stages. Without Miyamoto's approval, The Thousand Year Door wouldn't have been made at all. It was only after significant reworks and one inspired technical showcase that the team were finally able to convince Miyamoto that the game was worth making. They went on to create one of, if not the, most beloved Mario role-playing game of all time. This is the story of how Paper Mario: The Thousand Year Door was saved from the waste paper bin. Shigeru Miyamoto's long-term role as an overseer and producer for Nintendo games has had a profound impact on the types of games that the company has developed over the years. It is not an accident that Nintendo itself rarely makes role-playing games. Instead, when the company does publish RPGs, they're typically made by other companies, such as Intelligent Systems, who make the Paper Mario games. In a 2002 interview, Miyamoto said of the role-playing game genre, "I personally have a fundamental dislike of the RPG system. I think that with an RPG, you are completely bound hand and foot and can't move. But gradually you become able to move your hands and legs, you become slightly untied, and in the end, you feel powerful. So what you get out of an RPG is a feeling of happiness. But I don't think there's something that's fundamentally fun to play." Miyamoto's disdain for role-playing games can be seen in the evolution of the Legend of Zelda series, a series that he refuses to call role-playing games. In an interview in 1992, he said, "I think this gets into the problem of the definition of RPG, but personally, I think of Zelda as a real-time adventure game. I'm not interested in systems where everything in the game is decided by stats and numbers. What's important to me is to preserve as much of that live feeling as possible. For example, when your sword becomes twice or four times as powerful, by that point you've progressed pretty far in the game and the player's skill has probably increased too. So when you swing the sword, it should actually feel and sound sharper, more deadly. I think action games are better suited in conveying that sensation to players." In that same 1992 interview, he said, "In video games, I think the important thing is that it feels good when you're playing it, and that quality is not determined by the story but by the controls, the sound, and the rhythm and pacing. Thus, to gain Miyamoto's approval, a game project can't rely simply on storytelling and traditional RPG gameplay." Which is exactly why The Thousand Year Door was such a hard sell. When Ryota Kawade first joined Intelligent Systems, he wanted to be a game planner. This role in Japanese game design involves overseeing an entire project and making many of the big decisions about a game's fundamental design. Unfortunately, this role wasn't in high demand at the time, and as such, he applied for more technical design and programming positions as well. Kawade had tried his hands at a variety of different creative pursuits while in education. He'd drawn manga and experimented with filmmaking, but he felt that video games offered the best avenue for his creativity. He initially started in a design role in Intelligent Systems, but after a lot of hard work and effort, he was able to take on an increasing number of planning responsibilities as well, until, finally, he was tasked with planning the Paper Mario games. The first game had not been easy to make, The team had been so impressed with the Nintendo 64 launch title, Super Mario 64, that they were afraid that anything they did with Mario would be compared unfavorably to this seminal work. After trying a variety of different designs and even breaking into smaller teams to try to foster creativity, the developers eventually fell in love with a design that mixed 2D and 3D assets to create a colorful, paper-like world. This, apparently, left a strong impression on Miyamoto. He would later push the Mario RPG series to ditch its role-playing elements in favor of a strong focus on paper-based gameplay ideas. The first Paper Mario game was a more traditional RPG though, and it did mean that creating a sequel was difficult. Miyamoto had to sign off on the game, but his lack of interest in narrative meant that it wasn't simply enough to reuse mechanics to tell a new story. The developers needed to prove that the Paper Mario sequel wasn't just more of the same game on GameCube. They had no idea how to do this. Early attempts to get Miyamoto on board proved fruitless. The team attempted to appeal to his enjoyment of the paper art style of the Nintendo 64 game, but he was unimpressed. Developer Kenshiro Uedea later said, "Actually, the very first challenge Mr. Kawade and others had to face was how to convince Mr. Miyamoto. For example, we had to explain how we'd utilize the idea of things being flimsy like paper to a large degree in the final game. The utilization of paper-like elements was more of an improvement for him than an innovation, since the original idea was there with the N64 version. We were supposed to generate the novelty aspect as well. Unfortunately, we could not receive the passing mark from Mr. Miyamoto regarding this novelty test when we presented the planning sheet. The team needed to come up with something that could differentiate their plan for Thousand Year Door, or else the game wouldn't ever be given approval. Miyamoto and Nintendo as a whole are never above shelving a game project if they just don't think it's going to work." Finally, the developers at Intelligent Systems came up with a solution. They programmed a prototype that took advantage of the relatively simple 2D polygonal characters that made up the world of Paper Mario. While the GameCube was more advanced than the Nintendo 64, there were limits to how many 3D polygonal models could appear in any given level. But these limits were significantly reduced when dealing with models that were completely flat. Thus, the big idea that saved Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door: what if the game featured crowd scenes with 1,000 characters all on screen at once? Said Ueda. When Intelligent Systems finished programming for 1,000 characters and showed it to him, Mr. Miyamoto finally gave the game his go-ahead. It appears that what we presented him with was what he had wanted to do in the N64 version. So, how did the Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door developers win Miyamoto's approval and save their game from the scrap heap, in spite of the bias against role-playing games that existed at Nintendo? Simple. They made Paper Mario a bit more like Pikmin. One of Miyamoto's big goals for the GameCube hardware was rendering hundreds of characters on screen at a time. And while the first Pikmin game had achieved this to a certain degree, he wanted to push it further. He later said of his work on the series, "We just felt that the things we were trying to achieve in the original Pikmin, we weren't able to fully accomplish on GameCube. The flat, simple models of a Paper Mario game were the perfect opportunity to further experiment by rendering far more characters than would otherwise be possible. Given that this experimentation was so dear to Miyamoto's heart, it's not a surprise that the prospect of sprawling, epic crowd scenes managed to catch his attention. The rest is history. Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door was greenlit, and went on to become one of the most beloved GameCube RPGs, with critics and players agreeing that the title is among the best story-driven games that Nintendo has ever produced. The moral of the story? Sometimes, to collaborate with others, it's worth finding ways to compromise. Not everyone will be happy all of the time, but with a bit of flexibility, everyone can at least be pleased with something. And if you're ever called on to give a presentation to Shigeru Miyamoto, don't expect him to spare your feelings."